All right, good evening, everyone. Welcome to Throne with Logic for the 7th of May 2016. Just a quick introduction to the show, a live weekly, well, bi-weekly skeptical call-in show. We discuss all kinds of topics here. We do welcome calls, as you can see on the screen. If you want to call in at any point, add the Skype contact Throne with Logic. Just do send us a few quick PMs so I can get the gist of your question, and then I'll add you to the conference call. Just please try calling us. Like I said, it just distracts and annoys us. I don't think this there is one thing that was brought up, and that is why we don't do this on Google. We have many reasons. First of all, mainly it's just a lot of our guests don't know how to use Google Hangouts, and we find Skype is just easier. And also for people calling in, some folk don't know Hangouts. And lastly, all the Google chat just plain sucks. We can't really interact with the chat room as well. Anyway, quickly, we'll just get on with introducing the team. Marty, what's up?
Not much.
Right, and Nathan, how's it going?
It's going pretty good. How are you?
Oh, yeah, I'm doing grand. It's sort of starting to be not as cold in Scotland. Anyway, we'll quickly get on with the main topic of the show. So, Nathan, you've got a nice little introduction.
Yes, our guest today is Shawn Otto. He is an American novelist, screenwriter, political strategist, and science advocate. He is co-founder and producer of the U.S. Presidential Science Debates, which is an initiative to encourage candidates to openly discuss science, technology, health, and environmental issues. He is the author of two nonfiction books, 2011's Fool Me Twice, Fighting the Assault on Science in America, and a brand new book coming out called The War on Science. He joins us on the show today to talk about the relationship between politics and science in America and abroad. Welcome to the show, Shawn Otto.
Thanks. Really happy to be here.
Yeah, pleasure to have you. And as always, Nathan, you can get away with the question.
All right, well, I thought we'd start by talking about the science debates of 2008 and 2012 that you helped to organize sort of as a springboard for talking about the larger question of why it is that politicians seem so unwilling to openly discuss issues relating to science. What were some of the challenges that most stood out to you in getting that project up and running?
Well, it was really amazing that within a couple of weeks, it went viral, and we had 38,000 scientists and engineers signed on, and the CEOs of major companies, the presidents of 171 different major U.S. universities, lots of members of Congress, dozens of Nobel laureates, and still we couldn't get the candidates to engage on the big science issues. So you had virtually the whole U.S. Science and engineering enterprise at that time asking for this. And I started talking to news directors at different networks and editors of different major newspapers to try and figure out what was going on. Because we had noticed, for instance, just to take one example, climate change. 2008, by the time we started really organizing in January of 2008, we started in November of 2007, but by January of 2008, we noticed that in 171 different interviews conducted with the candidates by the five leading network news anchors, at that point in time, they'd asked 2,975 questions, almost 3,000 questions. Six of them were about climate change or global warming in any way. So that shows you kind of the relative importance that the news media placed on the largest science policy question ever to face any government. And to put that in perspective, there were three questions about UFOs. So something really weird was going on in American journalism, and we wanted to get to the root of that. So I was prodding these news directors and editors and asking, why aren't you guys covering this? We've got the entire U.S. science establishment really pushing for this level of discussion. Science is impacting every aspect of life, technology through technology, but through complex science, every aspect of life on the planet, posing these major policy challenges that are going unsolved and unresolved because we don't know how to talk about them, and we're not talking about them in our political process. and you guys aren't covering it. What is going on? And they said, well, we think it's a niche topic. Not that many people are interested. And I talked to the members of the different campaign, the staffers of different campaigns, and they said, well, we don't really want to have like a Dan Quayle moment, is what one of a Republican staffer said to me. And I said, what does that mean? And he said, you know, where you make some embarrassing factual statement that turns out not to be true. And so we decided, you know, we have to, first of all, set them at ease about this. We're not out to get you. We're not interested in you telling us about the details of cell mitosis or how a virus works or what the fourth digit of pi is. So we put together these big policy questions and we publish them on the internet, like, you know, saying, all right, this is an open book test. This is what we'll ask you. We still couldn't get them to engage. So something had happened in the U.S. political system. A vast change had begun to happen from, say, the 1960s and 70s, where the science race was really driving a lot of federal politics. And now we couldn't talk about science. And so that's really what I started working on exploring in the first of my books, and then kind of developed more of an understanding of what was really going on in the next one that's coming out, called The War on Science.
So could I ask for a spoiler then, what is going on?
Yeah, well, I think that part of it is there are three things going on, really. First is we have laid this great groundwork for a rise of kind of anti-science politics in a number of ways. The rise of kind of the postmodern movement in the news media, where journalism schools teach the media that, teach journalists, they have for two generations now, that there's no such thing as objectivity. And you'll see it in newspaper reporter guidelines. You'll see it by being repeated on the speaker circuit by major news figures. But that's a problem when so much is really driven by objective knowledge developed from science. And if journalists don't believe that there is such a thing as objectivity, then they're much more likely to create a situation of false balance where, say, they put, you know, James Hansen, say, on one half of the screen, or Michael Mann, or someone else that is speaking, representing the accumulated knowledge accumulated by hundreds or thousands of scientists conducting tens of thousands of experiments, working with billions of data points over half a century. And then you have a really compelling, charismatic person that has a good story to tell on the other side. And you present them as an argument. And that makes compelling media, but what it does is it elevates the unsupported, unscientific side, and it sways the whole public conversation towards extreme positions. So that's a big problem in the way that we teach journalism. And I understand the idea of guarding against your own subjectivity and acknowledging it, that first of all, it makes for really compelling reporting. But it also is important because you are not passing something off as objective when it's not. But on the other hand, the journalism has really gone too far the other way right now. So we need a corrective, and that has combined with a lot of things going on in the public and in our general politics around science. I'm giving you a super long answer to a really short question, so I apologize. But
it deserves a long answer because it's really important to get the details right.
And it's very complex. But what we've seen happen is since the 1960s, really, and the publication of Silent Spring in 1962, and the birth of not only environmental science, but the environmental movement, industry, who at that point, up until that point in time, quickly commercialized new science and rushed it to market and made a lot of money, suddenly were being confronted by science that was saying, wait a minute, we haven't fully taken into consideration some of the environmental consequences of, or some of the health consequences of some of this early science that we've been putting out there. So suddenly industry for the first time was being opposed by science. And that caused the beginning of a schism between older, particularly petrochemical, agribusiness, some cases pharmaceutical industry and science. Then about 10 years later, with the advent of the pill and other advances in reproductive medicine, the biological sciences suddenly found themselves being opposed by traditionalists in religion, very conservative religions. And at the same time, we saw a rise in news media, and a lot of those conservative religions and their preachers were taking advantage of that because they saw that science was really becoming dominant in society. So a coalition began to coalesce around the biological and environmental sciences between old industry and old religion. That really in many ways defines the modern party structure in the United States. And I've argued for 8 years that what we're seeing is not a shift between or not an argument between left and right in the politics anymore. And I think that's become really evident in the Donald Trump candidacy. It's really a top-down argument. Politics is not just a left-right continuum. It is a plane made up of conservative and progressive on the left and right. And by the way, science is both conservative and progressive. You have to research and embrace all the known knowledge so you don't embarrass yourself before you publish on something. But you also always need to be aware of the cutting edge because that's where new knowledge is developed. So science is value neutral on the conservative progressive. But there is also a topic.
If I can interrupt, another thing where science is both progressive and conservative is
sorry,
that sometimes
I can't take in all those words at once. Can you try again?
My phone is telling me it can't take in all those words at once. Can I try again? I hope the audience doesn't feel that way.
What I was saying is that sometimes an older idea turns out to be correct, and then. You know, science won't move forward regarding that particular issue. I mean, we still accept that the Earth is round, for example. Just because that's something that was accepted a long time ago doesn't mean that, hey, the Earth is flat now all of a sudden. Let's be progressive.
Right.
I mean, that's stupid.
Exactly. Although, if evidence started to accumulate that showed that the Earth was flat, that's where scientists would go with it.
Yes,
and
exactly.
That's really...
And so sometimes it's going to be conservative and sometimes it's going to be progressive.
Exactly.
That's the point I was making.
Yes, and it's a very good point. And so what's going on right now in our politics, much more than the left-right divide, is a top-down divide between science, which is anti-authoritarian in that it takes nothing on faith. It says, show me the evidence and I'll decide for myself. Versus authoritarianism on the bottom. And this argument that is going on is much more compelling in our social issues today between those who really do not like or accept or want or who oppose, actually actively oppose, the advances that science and evidence are suggesting on the one hand and those who don't on the other. And so I think that's what we're seeing even in the rise of Donald Trump is he's taking a very authoritarian approach in his politics, and that is splitting the Republican Party between the authoritarians and those who haven't. So you had asked another component of what's driving it, and in the next book, I talk about really the three fronts of the war on science. And the first front, or the first battlefield, is the postmodern battlefield. I had a friend who's a screenwriting instructor, professor, and he was over at the house a couple of weeks ago. And we were talking about this stuff, and he teaches at a local college, and he sits on the tenure review board. And in that capacity, he sits in the classes of professors that are up for tenure. And he sat in the back of this one professor's class, and he heard her talking about how we can't really know that the Earth goes around the sun. And after class, this is kind of flabbergasting. So he pulled her aside and said, that was kind of like you're being Socratic, right? Or you kind of raise their level of concern, get an interesting response, and get a conversation going, right? And she said, no, we can't know that the Earth. And, this is a humanities class, but he thought that this was really shocking and really irresponsible. So he went to the tenure committee, which was him and two others, and he said, I'm going to oppose this. I don't think that we should be granting tenure to someone who is teaching that we can't know that the Earth goes around the sun. And the two other members of the tenure committee said, well, we can't. Haven't you read Thomas Kuhn? Don't you know about the structure of scientific? Haven't you read Michael Behe? I mean, science has been proven wrong numerous times. So this idea that all truth is relative and that your authority as a speaker only extends so far as your political identity group is really dangerous, and it lays a intellectual foundation for what is going on in the media, in our politics. And where it takes us is that we don't have a common baseline of knowledge then that is developed from nature, since we all live in nature, that we all agree on. Then all of a sudden, truth is a matter of our gender or our racial identity or our sexual orientation. When in fact, what science is about is pulling what's knowledge out from all of those biases and developing what is reliable regardless of your. So we get confused there, and that comes from our universities, and we've been teaching it for 40 years now. Then there's the ideological war on science, which are the people I talked about, fundamentalists who are biblical literalists, and they don't like the advances, particularly around human biology. And they form the foot soldiers for the industrial war on science, which is industrial-funded think tanks and public relations campaigns designed to confuse the public and short-circuit democracy when science is suggesting something inconvenient that is a threat to their business model.
I just want to cut out this to go back a little bit, and it's like what you were saying about journalism, and this is end the kind of professional job. Can you expand on that, Nathan?
I've seen a little bit of that. It's not emphasized everywhere, at least not where I was taught journalism, but it is a problem that I have read about and have seen firsthand. So I don't think there's anything to defend. I think it's an accurate charge, right. And I think it's borne out in what we see as the products of journalism, especially science journalism, with the false balance that Shawn was talking about, and just the lack of accountability when science journalism gets something incredibly wrong. There's not a lot of people calling it out. And I think that false balance and that postmodernism, whether it's explicitly taught or just implicitly assumed by students and teachers, is kind of at the root of that. And that's something I personally would like to see changed myself. That's something I would like to advocate for, is a return to just a return to good science and good knowledge in objectivity in journalism.
It's a thorny question. Jay Rosen at NYU talks and blogs about it a lot. He's very articulate on it. And to, you know, in defense of the idea, there's some really important notions that it contains, that a journalist, by the very nature of it being human, which is the same thing that science tries to get at, by the way, carries implicit biases. And those implicit biases inevitably color and influence their reporting. So they need to be aware of those biases and acknowledge them. But where it becomes confusing for many journalists is where they take that idea, like a biblical literalist, and rely on it as a golden rule, and they take it too far, because there are areas where there is objective knowledge and where their personal biases really have no bearing, and they should be balancing the scales by presenting the side that has the weight of the evidence on it. You know, David Gregory, in political journalism, not just science journalism, I don't think, was a good example of this. He was at the time the NBC chief White House correspondent, and after the United States invaded Iraq, a lot of people were saying, how come you guys at the White House press corps didn't push the Bush administration for their complete lack of evidence supporting the assertion that Saddam Hussein was developing weapons of mass destruction, chemical, biological, and nuclear weapons. And he said, I respectfully disagree. That's not our role. And maybe Nathan has a perspective on that. But my view is that the role of journalism is to question those in authority and to form a feedback mechanism for the public, and that is to demand evidence when assertions are made that have national bearing.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think journalists have the potential to be good mediators between people who are perceived to be in the ivory tower and the public at large. Part of their role is to be observers and to hold their biases in check. And another part of that is to actually accurately relay information. So there needs to be a balance there. And I think the term balance in journalism used to mean something different than it means now. Prior to the fairness doctrine being repealed, balanced actually meant objective. And now it means somehow there doesn't need to be objectivity in
there should be a balance between what's true and what's false. So sometimes we have to report false things as true or something like that.
Exactly.
We do have a caller who's just joined in. Well, it's another Shawn. So Shawn, can you hear me?
I sure can, guys.
All right, welcome to the show. You're on with other Shawn, so Shawn, ask Shawn a question.
Well, you actually just touched on it. I was wanting to ask about if you saw any possible way, with the way our media is set up right now being a ratings-based system, if we could ever go back to any kind of objectivity.
Well, I think that Nathan really... Thank you, Shawn. Very intelligent question, by the way. I think that Nathan touched on that when he referenced the Fairness Doctrine. That was an FCC policy that was repealed under President Reagan. And the policy was that the major networks, in exchange for their use of the public airwaves, had a responsibility to present both sides of controversial issues that had public merit, and to do it in a way that was fact-based and fair in the view of the FCC. And Reagan abolished that. There were attempts by Congress to reinstate it. It was never in law. It was a rule. And those attempts failed. Reagan vetoed them, and further attempts were not successful. But a lot of people have talked about that as one way to solve this problem. Arguments against it have been made even by the Obama administration early on when he referenced the marketplace of ideas and that we shouldn't be limiting that in any way. But my response to that is that we are not in a marketplace of ideas so much as we are in a marketplace of emotions. Because when news shows are forced to compete for ratings in that way, they have to go for what drives audience response and ratings, and that is always about emotion. And so, you know, from my other work as a screenwriter, I know that what Hollywood turns to motivate people, the four main things that playwrights have used since the time of the Greeks are sex, violence, drama, and comedy. And so we see The Daily Show, a comedy show, becoming the most trusted news show in America. And we see things like the Naked News in other countries try to sell the news that way. Rush Limbaugh does drama with, you know, just charging people's amygdala up with outrage. And that's kind of been his formula. So all these people are competing for ratings, but that competition is driving us away from ideas and towards what motivates different people in different ways. And at the same time, then you have the internet that is breaking things down in terms of news sources. So people are more and more just going towards the news that confirms their point of view. So it's becoming very problematic. But I think that there is still a reasoned argument to be made that the broadcast media, the major networks, since they are using the public airwaves, could be the kind of the voice of reason in this, if you will. If we went back to something like the Fairness Doctrine, and Nathan probably has a far smarter opinion on that.
Thank you.
Got anything else there, Sean?
Yep, that does it for me. Thanks for having me on.
All right, thanks very much, Sean. Thanks. Mm-hmm.
I was interested. You mentioned the internet. I noticed an advantage in getting news from the internet, specifically because it's not about competing for ratings. Sure, it's about competing for likes on Facebook instead or views on YouTube. But the point is, it's not like, hey, you're not getting enough views, so you don't get to speak at all.
Right.
So I could this be a step in the right direction, at least? I mean, sure, you mentioned the problem that people will watch the news that confirm what they already believe, but, well, they were already doing that anyway. I mean, conservatives were watching Fox. I mean, that's not really new. So isn't it a step in the right direction anyway?
Maybe if there's a way to, there's a way that we haven't thought of yet to avoid the disaggregation or, you know, the aggregation really of thought across the internet. There's a lot of value in diversity of views, but not if they don't commingle. So we, you know, that's what we see with Facebook, for instance, where people, a lot of people are starting to get their news from social media outlets like that, where they see an article that's interesting, they click on that, and then they share it. And part of that is just because part of our brain is authoritarian, naturally. I mean, we have these different aspects that we constantly war against. Even ourselves. I mean, that's why we developed a scientific method the way that we did. We know that we're prone to confirmation bias. This stuff is really hard. It's really hard to separate out what's really going on from what we perceive that is going on and what our emotions tell us is going on and what our various other biological drives and instincts tell us is going on in a certain situation. And we frequently misperceive what is happening. Common sense is the least reliable of the senses. So we develop that knowing that. And that's why, first of all, it's dangerous when we bring an authoritarian part of our brain to watching a news program, and the anchor is an authority. They speak with authority. They're chosen for their authoritarian bearing. We can trust what this father, or in the case of Fox, this hot young mother figure, I don't know if I'd even say mother figure, says, but they try to speak with authority, and that is to take advantage of that. And then if we don't critically question what is being presented, and if what is being presented there is slanted, it becomes a serious problem. And the Fox reference that you made, you know, Fox really developed that formula post abolishment of the Fairness Doctrine.
Yeah, I think about the internet, there's, on YouTube, for example, there's a lot of content out there that is really good, knowledge-wise, for gaining knowledge, and it's thrown in with a lot of nonsense. But I think I'm seeing a lot of content being put on the internet that's really valuable, almost more valuable than what you would find. Maybe not as valuable as what you get in a college education, but certainly at least as valuable or more so than what you get in, say, a high school science class. There's a lot of science educators who aren't being paid by anybody putting knowledge out there and trying to get their voice heard through all the nonsense that's out there. And I think there's a critical mass approaching. I'm thinking of YouTube specifically. For example, whenever an anti-science video comes out, more and more it seems there's a lot of science advocates responding to it almost immediately, and there's a conversation happening. And I think that's one value of the internet that I see.
You can look at what's happened to many of those, especially if you look at creationism. Say 5-6 years ago, when I started making videos on YouTube, there were tons of really big creationist channels. I'm talking about, you know, Venom Fang X, Shock of God, Nephilim Free, I Die, you know, well, he wasn't that big, but, you know, Truthful Christian. You had all these people, and they're all gone now, and they haven't really been replaced. I think the only big creationist channel that's left is P.P. Simmons.
Yeah.
The other part is gone because they can't say a word without having it rammed right back where it came from.
I think you guys raise really good points. And so then what that means is what is a curatorial process, and how do you curate the internet? Because it's fantastic what we have access to. It's incredibly useful and really high quality information. But how, if you're not really science literate and you don't have time to pay attention to that, how do we curate that so that you can tell the difference?
It does boil down to, we'll have the friends on Facebook that natural news story. Fine, let's try correcting them and, well, why would they lie about this, would they?
Yeah, they wouldn't let anyone run a website.
Yeah.
Right, well, and that goes back to that authoritarian part of our brain. Now, you know, Andrew Wakefield is a great example. Right now, he's making all kinds of news because he's working. He realized that his main backers were celebrities, so... And people in kind of the pop cultural field, the Jenny McCarthy's of the world. So he decided, well, I can't really practice medicine anymore, and I've been kind of exposed to, as a scientist, and my papers were retracted. So I guess I'll make a movie. And all of a sudden we've got, you know, major news stories again about vaccinations and autism. And you know, Robert De Niro, even, who has an autistic son, had a really, really hard time struggling in public with this question and thinking that the issue hasn't been resolved. And working out his own personal lack of knowledge on it in the newspapers and on TV, which was unfortunate because, again, it started the whole thing all over again.
I think it's really sad that all these celebrities are...
Well, you have to understand... I mean,
they're celebrities. People expect celebrities to be these... I mean, you're famous. You have to know what you're talking about.
Right.
These people don't know jack shit about science.
No, they don't, by and large. But you have to understand what is going on there, too. And part of that is that same schism that I talked about in our politics. Generally, on the kind of the right, if you will, politically now, the anti-science is about climate change denial, or it's about opposition to any kind of reproductive control. It's the idea that liberal scientists with a socialist agenda are kind of trying to control your life and limit your freedom. And on the left, it's basically about unsupported fears of secret or hidden dangers to our health or the environment, which is a lot trickier because it's not without justification. Some of it is based on experience and on the birth of environmental science. But where the left gets into trouble is then they take that suspicion and expand it and apply it to everything. And that gives kind of a framework.
Into conspiracy theories, basically.
Exactly. They extend it where science doesn't support it.
Yeah.
So that's what's going on with the anti-vaccine thing. That's what's going on with a lot of the dietary supplement stuff. That's what's going on with a lot of the kind of the new age healing all the stuff about GMOs versus organic food. All of those things really are about hidden dangers to health or the environment.
All right, we've got a few chat room questions. I think I'll Ethan too.
I don't have the feed up on my computer.
I'm copying and pasting them.
It's in the Skype. Okay, yeah. Gotcha. So I can do that then.
Yeah, there's two questions just coming in there.
Okay, let me mute so I can click around for.
All right.
So all this goes back while he's looking to, you know, kind of Jefferson's idea at the beginning of democracy. Wherever the people are well-informed, they can be trusted with their own government. And that's gotten just so much harder to be well-informed these days because of the advances of science.
Yeah, science. There's too much to take in to be considered well-informed, yeah.
Right, so that's the challenge. And that's where we need even more people like Nathan, really, to bridge that gap, to keep people well-informed and to take... honestly, trustfully take what we do know from science and put it out there into the news stream and into the policymaking arena so we can make good judgments about it.
But another thing that I think is important is that we teach, maybe we don't need to teach so much, you know, people to understand what science says, but if people understand the scientific method,
right,
then,
exactly.
Then they can be trusted. When a scientist says, look, here's what the science shows, here's the consensus of the scientific community, then people will understand that, yeah, this is actually the best information available to us.
And right, exactly.
I don't have to be able to understand all these fancy equations and all these big words. I know that the people who do understand this are all in agreement.
That's what I just had the really good fortune. It was really fun to do a talk and a workshop for a group of New York has this program called the Master Teachers Program. And so they come on weekends and have speakers. And so I got to be there and meet with a lot of amazingly cool people. And we had a great conversation about what the role of science education should be these days. And I think that the most important place that we can go with this is exactly what you're saying, which is teaching the process of science, going back to those fundamental questions. What is the difference between alive and not alive, for instance, and using science to explore that that question, and instead of teaching the outcome, the right answer, teach how to think about it. And the kids that are naturally going to be interested in science, scientifically inclined, they're going to become hugely excited by that, and that's going to motivate them to go on and to get the actual factual knowledge. And the kids that aren't are still going to be well equipped to be good citizens in a science-driven society.
Yeah, okay, we've got one question from Malicious Bloke, who writes, given that confronting people with information contrary to their beliefs often leads to them hardening those beliefs, what do you think is the best way to dispel a lot of the anti-science rubbish out there?
Yeah, it's it's a very complex question, and there's emerging science on this. That's absolutely right, that confrontation just generally causes people to dig in, to reinvest in their position. There is some science that talks about opinion leaders and working on that level, because people who are particularly authoritarian in their thinking tend to trust authority figures. And if authority figures in their cohort start talking differently about science, all of a sudden they move along with them. And it's pretty remarkable to see, but that actually does happen. Another very interesting set of experiments was done recently around a political method of talking to people about transgender politics, and going door to door, canvassing them, talking to them one-on-one about this. This was written up in Science Magazine recently, featured in a segment on This American Life, which was a really good segment. I'd encourage you to find that podcast from several weeks ago and listen to it. But it was fascinating because working people through it, breaking it down, and kind of unwinding the tarball and talking about personal relationships that people had, all of a sudden people could start hearing about these things. And instead of falling into the rhetorical traps that public relations campaigns essentially or that religious leaders had created for them. So I think that there's emerging strategies on this. I don't think that they're super well defined yet, but the encouraging news is that some really exciting new techniques are being developed.
Yep, and we've got two more. Did you want me to read those now?
Yeah, we'll crack on with a few chat room questions at the moment.
Okay, Bulletproof Bullet writes, does Sean think that we can bridge this gap, or will the knowledgeable have to go their own way and just ignore the regressives until we leave them in the dust economically? Do we start the Epsilon class?
Wow. There are so many great ideas kind of wrapped up in that one question. I think that there's a certain amount of that striation going on in society right now between the knowledge haves and the knowledge have-nots. And the have-nots are those people that Donald Trump is appealing to in particular right now. And you could say that that is a big portion of the political equation that's going on. I think that it's dangerous, though. And I'm not convinced that it's not something that is to a greater or lesser degree somewhat cyclical. About 100 years ago, it was the Democratic Party that was ardently anti-science. They were campaigning against the teaching of evolution in science class. That led to the Scopes trial. At that point in time, scientists were generally Republican because they didn't want to be associated with Democrats and their anti-science authoritarian ideological thinking. And some of the comments that amazing leading scientists, like people like Robert Millikan, were were publishing in Science Magazine at the time, comparing Democrats to apes and things like that. They were pretty remarkable. So I think that we can also look back to people like, you know, Andrew Jackson and kind of the know-nothings. This type of thing happens from time to time when the conditions are right in our politics. I do think that we are faced with a kind of an increasing crisis over this question of how do we incorporate complex science into our policymaking that we do need to figure out how to solve. I'm optimistic that we can figure out how to do it, otherwise I wouldn't be spending this much time on it. But I think we have to absolutely get there, or we are going to fall into that kind of society, absolutely.
There's one last chat room question.
All right. Again, Bulletproof Bullet writes, with the rise of the internet and YouTube shows like SciShow, but also all the other skeptic channels, will this be a generational divide? Does it look like the millennials will have different political outlooks?
They definitely do have different political outlooks. And I think that some of that is, again, cyclical. It's very interesting to compare this kind of this inflection point that we're at in our politics to the inflection point that we're at with the rise of Ronald Reagan, which was the first time that the baby boom generation, which at that time was the largest emerging voting demographic, were really fully voting en masse. You know, the leading edge had been voting for a decade or more than a decade, but the youngest were finally voting at that point. And they were very self-oriented and anti-government, always had been throughout their teens. The Vietnam War was going on, the Nixon, Watergate. There were a lot of reasons that the government couldn't be trusted. And Reagan took advantage of that focus very successfully in his messaging. These days, the millennials are the next largest population demographic, the kids of those baby boomers. And they are really fully voting. I think the leading edge is 36, 37, 39, somewhere in there. So they're really fully voting for the first time this election. And they are, they've been brought up largely on social media. So they're not as self-focused. They're much more egalitarian so far, from what we've been able to tell with what limited studies there are, probably because of their ties on social media, where they want fairness and connection. They certainly are interested in their individual success, but they also want to maintain their social connection with their peers.
So it's quite interesting what you say with millennials, because that's Vance Crowe on, and that's job title is he's a director of millennial engagement. And it's quite interesting you say that and kind of what his experience trying to sell, well, trying to demystify Monsanto to a lot of people.
That would be a really interesting.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, he's someone you should go and look and, you know, he is. It's quite interesting what he does. Plus, he's a nice guy as well.
Yeah, I'll check that out.
All right. And we have a caller. I'll just add them. Marty or Nathan, you can come in.
Yeah, one thing that came to mind when we were talking about this was how things are changing now that new people are voting. I mean, if you look at the whole Bernie Sanders thing, and if it doesn't look like that's turning out too well, when you compare this with like what it would have been like 20 years ago,
right?
He wouldn't have had one person voting for him.
No, absolutely. And he's
now
got
he's almost he almost became nominated. I don't understand if I don't know if that's completely a done deal yet, but
it's not a done deal. Although Clinton have a large electoral advantage, right?
Yeah, exactly. But the thing is, he wouldn't even have been worth mentioning in the past.
Right. Yeah, you're absolutely right. And his support, he has something like north of 90% of the support of the millennials, particularly the youngest end of that spectrum. And I think a lot of that is driven by those factors, absolutely. Clinton's advantage. By the way, she is arguably, it's somewhat of a toss-up between them on their positions on science. Sanders is has a much more aggressive climate policy. The climate scientists really prefer his position on climate. But he kind of veers into some anti-science stuff around GMOs and health foods and alternative medicines and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
That Clinton does not.
Yeah, but if we look at on the other side, if we look at Trump, I mean,
right. The most fascinating thing about Trump and kind of this the whole vaccine thing was that. Really, this advent of conservatives being anti-vax is somewhat of a new thing that developed after Michelle Bachmann in the last presidential election talked about HPV vaccines. Again, this is about control over the human reproductive cycle. And then religious conservatives are afraid that you give a girl an HPV vaccine, all of a sudden it will embolden her to have sex because you'll remove the negative consequence of potentially contracting cervical cancer down the road. I don't know how many people who have daughters think that they actually think about that kind of thing when they're confronted with the idea of having sex. But that's where it began to change, and Trump really amped that up this time.
Is that everything, Marty, Nathan? We can go to our caller. Julia, are you there?
Yes, hello.
Yeah, there you are. Nice to hear from you. You're on here with the team. Ask a question.
Right, okay. So I was wondering what you think that we as non-politicians can do to kind of reverse this trend of anti-science in politics?
Absolutely. Thanks, Julia. A number of things. One is you can go to sciencedebate.org and sign on as a supporter there and tell your friends to do that too. We are still working to get the candidates for president to talk about the big science issues, not taking a position on judging them about the outcome. We think that the voters are smart enough and the voters can make an informed decision based on that. But if we create a safe space for a conversation about these issues, we will bring together the politicians, the media, public, and science, and hopefully create a constructive conversation that will inject these ideas back into our political process. So that's one step. I mean, the book, The War on Science, has 12 what I call battle plans, which are exactly that, ways for people to help fight this and to reengage in the process. There are a lot of others. And I don't have time to go into all of them, but I'll make another suggestion. One is anytime you see media doing a false balance in their reporting, call them on it. Because those ombudsmen there at those newspapers or websites or networks really do, they are charged with investigating those kinds of things. And it does have an impact on the kind of reporting. We are slowly, I think, all of us in the science community are slowly having an impact on educating journalists that they do have to focus on more on the objective knowledge that is developed by science and not just presenting it as one half of an argument. So those are two ideas anyway, and you can pre-order the book and find more.
Okay, so what about sending messages like letters to the politicians themselves? Do you see that having an impact?
Absolutely. I spoke to a member of Congress once about this, and I asked them what constitutes a groundswell of support, because I saw you say in a newspaper about something that there was a groundswell of support. And that member said 12 letters. That constitutes a groundswell, but not 12 form letters, because we count all of those. If we get like hundreds of them, then they're obviously being generated by some advocacy group and people are just, you know, signing on and copying them and sending them in. We kind of just kind of figure that's, you know, communication from that advocacy group. But if people individually call on an issue or write a letter in their own words on an issue, we count that. And that makes a difference. Another thing that if you are scientifically literate, is contact your member of Congress and volunteer to be a science advisor. You will probably find that they don't have a science advisor, or your member of parliament, depending on where you're listening. And if they don't, volunteer to be that person and to provide nonpartisan advice to them on what the science says on certain issues. And that would be a really helpful contribution to make.
Okay, that's great to hear.
All right.
That was it. Thank you very much for having me on.
All right. Thanks for the call. Much appreciated.
Thanks, Julia.
That's actually interesting that make a difference with that few letters, because I was under the impression that in order to get politicians at any level to give a damn about anything, there had to be so many people complaining about something that they would realize that they were, you know, this is going to affect an election.
Yeah, I think that what they kind of think about it, that if one person is taking the time to write me or contact me this way in a personal, individual way, there's got to be a lot more people that feel the same way that just aren't taking the time. But I was surprised and heartened to learn that too.
Yeah. Ethan, do you have anything there?
Don't have anything at this moment.
Because there is one thing, we seem to be focused quite a lot on media, and that's one area where I feel a whole anti-science thing is that is a phenomenon of mommy blog.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so I don't know, Shawn, have you come across them? And, like, because I find this area is very, very difficult to actually get charged with emotion, and kind of goes back to what we talked about before I went on air with people like Melissa McCarthy. So if people are so emotionally charged like that, is there any way you can engage?
It's really hard. And I think that in that kind of thinking, which is largely, again, dominated by kind of postmodernist thinking, then the only person who really has authority there is someone who is speaking from that perspective. So it has to be a member of the peer group. It has to either be a mommy blogger, or it has to be a mom, at least, that is willing to be a conduit to bring scientists in, to say, look, we owe it to our kids to really arm ourselves with the facts instead of with fear or superstition, in order to really fully protect them. I mean, that almost seems like it's a kind of a no-brainer, right? You would want to access the best knowledge that people have sacrificed their lives to create, and use it to your advantage to protect and develop your child.
But it seems to me like that's what they're rebelling against. They're basically saying, look, here's all this knowledge, but we can't trust that because that's all, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
And partly science itself is somewhat to blame, and partly science journalism is to blame there, because it does seem like, you know, any time, you know, once a month, there'll be a study, some kind of dietary study that comes out that contradicts something that went before. You know, red wine is good for you. No, it's not. Yeah. Fat is good for you. No, it's not. And what's the sad thing is a lot of those studies are actually fake studies that are pushed by people with an agenda to sell a product, often in the first place. And the mainstream media winds up picking them up somehow. Somebody does a story on it. The statistics are manipulated. The data is real, but people don't understand that the statistics are manipulated. And then the story gets picked up by another outlet and another, and pretty soon it's all over the internet.
Yeah, I just want to come in, because there was a really good example that popped to mind. I remember this very clearly. It's in a really good book. I don't know if you've read it, Sean. It's Ben Goldacre's book called Bad Science.
I haven't read his book, but
yeah, I recommend. But anyway, just there was one really good example. This, if anyone's heard of this, where they say a certain day in January, which they say is the most.
I've read about that.
Yeah,
that rings a bell with me. Is it the blue day or
yeah,
blue
it's something like that. They say, well, this is the most depressing day, and they actually, well, Ben looked it up, and he actually found this wasn't really even a study. This was just. Actually a bunch of tour operators got together, and it was just to get people out to buy tours at that time of year to book their summer vacations, but people saying this is
classic.
Oh, this is scientifically proven, this day is really depressing, and kind of in the article it was saying, you know, oh, here's things you could do, start planning for your summer vacation. But, you know, I know it's right. A little bit of a flippant one,
right.
But it shows how this stuff goes on.
It's a beautiful example. And then you take that and you take people who are taught that we can't know for sure that the Earth goes around the sun and that science is constantly contradicting things and that your only real sense of authority is your personal experience. It's not hard to see why people become confused and distrusting.
Yeah. Sorry, Marty.
What I was going to say is, isn't it also often the case that I mean, when you look at any meta-analysis, you're going to find studies that are outliers. Well, at some point, that study, that outlier that got a result that contradicted everything else that was known on that topic, for whatever reason, that was published, and, well, someone who didn't know all that much about the subject heard about that study. And that's all.
Right.
Then the next study comes out, confirms that, yeah, this was indeed a fluke. Oh, science is contradicting itself.
Right, exactly. It's just like, if you imagine that on a graph, right?
Yeah.
With a track. Place, they'll be up and down, up and down, up and down. But overall, the trend line will be centering around them, and they'll be getting narrower and narrower and narrower as we develop more and more knowledge and more evidence. But yes, I think that again, people who don't have knowledge of statistics and understand that that's part of the process can be confused by it really easily.
And the other thing is, outlier studies are the ones that get more easily noticed by media,
right,
who want to sell sensationalism.
Yeah, exactly.
Because get back to the shape of the Earth example. This is something I've said. Why do flat earthers get so many views on YouTube? Well, because they're saying something that contradicts, you know, what's normal, what's normally
right.
Accepted. They're the ones with the bright idea. They're the ones who are standing out. How many views do you think you get if you make a video saying the Earth is round?
Right.
Yeah, we know that, dumbass.
And that's why you see flat earthers and also people who try to argue against the theory of relativity or what have you like to compare themselves to Galileo, and they like to think that heresy equals truth.
Yeah, exactly. I know. Yeah, like Rick, former Texas governor, he did that in the national debate 4 years ago. Rick Perry.
Oh, Rick Perry.
Yeah. We, like I said, Marty, you're probably aware of this, and Nathan encountered this after our last show went up. Recording went up on YouTube. We had this guy, this was the show with, and we were talking a lot about Zika, and he kept saying, but 30 years ago, Zika, I can't remember the name of the condition.
Is it Guillain-Barré?
Microcephaly? Syndrome?
What's it?
Microcephaly.
And Concordance actually provided, well, here's links. Yeah, but that's just recently, so why has it changed now? This guy, he then started linking, look, this paper says likely, possible. Why can't they say certain? And I think this is another problem. A lot of people, when they check the scientific papers, they analyze the language of a scientific paper. That's something else.
I think that's right. Even the scientific community sometimes, you know, in 2011, the World Health Organization released a study that said that your cell phone, it's been shown that your cell phones may cause brain cancer. Well, that's always going to be a scientifically valid statement. It may happen. There is a statistical chance. But if you actually read the study, the statistical chance was just about the noise level. It was almost indistinguishable from noise. It was an irresponsible headline on their part, but it led to all kinds of municipalities considering forcing cell phone shops to warn everybody that their cell phones could cause brain cancer. Even though if you understand a little bit about biology, a little bit about physics, a little about chemistry, you know that that's physically not possible. Yeah. Microwave photons are not strong enough to do that.
Mm-hmm. And what's interesting is I actually asked that that part of the course I'm teaching in high school. Something people should know.
Nathan, as you're on chat room question duty, others popped up there.
All right. Yes, two more. Both from Bulletproof Bullet again. He asks Sean, "Do you think it's hard to get skeptics?"
Is he the only one watching?
It's a good question.
We should just have him on.
Do you think it's hard to get skeptics to write politicians and news channels? I mean, generally, skeptics are in advanced scientific fields and have to take time out of their day cracking the mysteries of the universe to write people who should be professionals to tell them to do their basic homework.
Yeah, it's totally frustrating. I completely agree that nobody should have to do that. On the other hand, it's part of the way that science is in society. And it used to be that scientists did a lot more public outreach because they had to, because that's how they got funded. You know, back in the early part of the 20th century, 1920s, say, Edwin Hubble, astronomer, would speak to standing room only crowds of 5,000 people about what he was seeing through the telescope at the Mount Wilson Observatory. I mean, that's remarkable when you think about it. After World War II and after Sputnik went up, really, and NSF, the National Science Foundation, was finally adequately funded, scientists needed to figure out a way to decide, all right, how are we going to responsibly disseminate this money? Well, we'll form committees and we'll entertain grant requests and then we'll judge them. So the system was set up where scientists only suddenly had to reach out and impress other scientists. And they started really withdrawing from public engagement. And this attitude kind of cropped in that politics was dirty and was below scientists and they shouldn't have to. And in fact, it was bad for them to engage in that. And there's strong disincentives grew up in our tenure system in the universities against public engagement. And there was something that came up called the Sagan effect. After Carl Sagan, one of the greatest popularizers of science, but also an incredibly productive scientist, published an average of scientific paper once a month over his 40-year career. But he was denied admission to the National Academy of Sciences. Largely, people thought because scientists were jealous because he was such a famous communicator. So there's all these different things that happened. And I think one of the things that we need to do is we need to get our national granting organizations to prioritize the funding of science communicators in labs and really more like 5% of a grant to fund ongoing engagement with the public. And yeah, sure, you don't want to burden the principal investigator all the time with that kind of thing, and they shouldn't have to. And they may not be good at it. A lot of brilliant scientists are horrible communicators, and you absolutely would not want them out there. but somebody should be. Yeah. And so again, it's about bridging that gap and bridging that divide, I think. Anything we can do to do that, we just need to make a much more profound investment in communication.
And perhaps we also have to, I'm sorry. Perhaps we also have to accept the idea that maybe the best science communicators aren't necessarily scientists.
Absolutely. And these days, we have to reward generalists, which are sometimes science communicators, but sometimes people background, but they're not specialists in a field, because a lot of the really cool new ideas are silo breaking.
All right, Nathan, do you want to come in there?
With another chat room question?
Yeah, might as well.
Yeah, okay. Again, bulletproof bullet. Should we all start our own companies selling dubious products targeting the easily fooled in order to use that money to dominate politics? Is it unethical to sell snake oil if we get rid of Reaganism?
Yes.
There we go.
I'll just let you interpret that one.
That sounds like a more of a tongue-in-cheek question than anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just talking about the communication. I want to go back to the papers. How do you think we could bridge that gap between a scientific paper with a scientist? It doesn't make a lot of sense. It seems contradictory. The language is just bizarre. How do you think we can translate that better?
That's absolutely a huge problem. And again, if we were funding more and better science communication within our labs, we could actually be translating those, those summaries into plain English. One of the other things that would be great, there are certain organizations that are working on this, is to actually take advantage of the internet to make a public library of science papers that are all hyperlinked together, which would make it much easier for independent bloggers and journalists who do not have access to major expense accounts to actually draw on the science that they need to do good reporting. There's part of the problem I think that we have gotten ourselves into is we've taught that with using critical thinking, you should be skeptical, which is great, but you have to take the next step further and say, all right, I'm going to be skeptical of claims. Where do I go to decide what's good information and what's not? And we're not somehow getting across that second step of, okay, this is the way that I can tell good information from bad. This is why statistics is not a dry, dull, boring topic. It's actually critical to navigating a successful life these days. And this is how you read a scientific paper, and this is why it's important. And we're not teaching the difference between tertiary, secondary, and primary information and how to tell the difference. So it's great to have critical thinkers, but they have to be equipped to actually make a good judgment about what to believe and what not to believe. Because without that, all they do is question everything, and then they go with what feels good.
Yeah. Or they go with, this is what's established, so I'm going to question that.
Right.
Here's a source that says the establishment is wrong. I will accept that because it confirms what I thought, namely that I should be skeptical of what the establishment says.
Yes.
It seems like there's a
professional contrarians who love doing that.
Yeah. Yeah, but this is how I think most conspiracy theorists reason. There's the established story, which is people did land on the moon. Here's a source that says people didn't land on the moon. Ah, well, it's a done deal.
Right. John Cook and Stephen Lewandowski have done some science on that. That really showed that people who believe in conspiracy theories tend to also be global warming deniers.
The amount of people that would have to be involved.
Yeah, that was a really cool paper to read.
Yeah, and the numbers just got...
How long it would have to take,
yeah.
How long it would be possible for it to remain...
I think
400,000 employees in the NASA Apollo program in 1969.
Yeah.
To keep that a secret, it would be a matter of days before the secret was leaked with that number of people.
It was just funny to read.
And then I think for 9/11 it was way up in the millions of.
Yeah.
Been easy to have been on it to for it.
It is hilarious.
There's a knee-jerk reaction, I think, among the anti-science / conspiracy theory crowd to the word establishment. They hear the word established science and they immediately react to that like, oh, established. Well,
this is what the Illuminati want you to believe.
I don't understand that. Established becomes established for a reason.
Yes, and that's what I keep saying all the time.
That's what I keep saying too. And when I say that scientists speak with authority on something, it's not that the scientist has the authority. They're speaking with the authority of nature.
Yeah.
So arguing with what they say when they're speaking in a scientific context is essentially arguing with nature.
Yeah.
They are the ultimate anti-authoritarians, and that's why this rise of anti-science among anti-authoritarians is so absurd.
Checking to see the chat. So I suppose you could give us a little preview of the tomorrow, or is?
Well, the official book launch was moved from mid-May to June 7th, but I actually think that you can order. I think you can order it now online. If you can't, it'll be available and shipping within a couple of days. So yeah, I would encourage people to check it out. It's gotten some really, I'm really proud. It's gotten some terrific reviews from like a former U.S. Vice President, Bill Nye, Michael Mann, who's a great climate scientist, Marsha McNutt, the incoming president of the United States National Academy of Sciences, some newscasters. The response so far, the preliminary early response is really positive. So I'm happy to report that. And I would love it if you check it out and find me online at shawnotto.com and shoot me an email and let me know what you think.
Link for the book and
I'll definitely be reading it. I just have a few more chapters left in your earlier book. I'm almost finished with it, and it's really good. So I would recommend that, and also reading the new one as well.
That's great.
And how does it differ from the first book?
It actually grew out of the first book. After I wrote the first book, I traveled to a number of different countries and kind of advised science debate efforts that were going on in largely among science journalists, but in parliamentary elections. In different countries, and got to see kind of the status of where science and politics was happening in around the world. And plus a lot of things have changed since 2011. So I took probably about 30 or 40% of that book as a starting point and then jumped off from there into kind of this larger picture of what's happening in this global movement against science.
We have had a question come in there. Marty, you were the one that uncovered it, so.
Yeah. It's from guess who?
Yeah.
bullet again. Shawn, will the change in politics only come after chaos, after bad events have happened that highlights the benefit of scientific thought to general society, the way that anti-vaxxers had backlash after outbreaks of preventable diseases?
You know, gosh, you really like to hope that isn't what it takes. The same thing is starting to happen around climate change. You know, people are saying, wait a minute, it's way warmer, the winter's way shorter, and there are a lot more wildfires and these strange diseases that are moving around or into northern climates from the tropics. I hope that those of us who are pro-science and who are science communicators are having an impact. I like to think that we are. I think that the tide is turning, frankly, and I'm hopeful that we'll be able to get together 10 years from now and say, wow, do you remember back then how crazy it was? Yeah. I really think that we'll be there, but I think that the challenges in maintaining that are tremendous because as knowledge expands, exponentially, we're going to be faced with this problem over and over again. And we just have to develop a better system of incorporating knowledge into our public conversation. If you think about this, with the number of scientists alive working now today, and the way that they are connected over the internet, we're in a position to create as much new knowledge over the next four decades as we have since the beginning of recorded history. And every time we make new knowledge, we also have to refine our morals and ethics and legal systems to incorporate the implications of that knowledge. And that's always a political process. And we sometimes have to redo our economic models and upset industries that are based on old models too. And that's a political process. So imagine that unless we find a better way of incorporating science, we're going to be in for a really bumpy ride.
Yeah, because I've been learning this currently back at college doing a degree in mechanical engineering. Our tutors have been parts of real technology is sadly made that after World War II brought us in terms of massive human cost, but probably the computers would not be at the stage that I hadn't been for Mr. Chu.
Absolutely.
That's true.
And there was one last question from somebody. Nathan, you can take it away.
Yeah, this comes from Microbloganism. He asks, does Sean have anything to say about the Freedom of Information attacks on people like Kevin Volta?
Yeah, that's kind of a growing issue where scientists who work for public universities are subject to abuse of the Freedom of Information Act by political opponents seeking whatever little nugget that they could find that they could take out of context, kind of like hide the decline in ClimateGate, anything like that. And the side benefit to them is even if they don't find something like that, they can paralyze a scientist by having to dig through all of this communication and figure out what's non-public and what's public and redact stuff, and it just becomes an incredibly burdensome process. And we need to find a better way of protecting freedom of inquiry while respecting transparency. But science is itself a after the fox in different holes. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I saw it cut out there for a little bit. You're back now.
Okay, all right. I said science is a bit like a fox hunt, and it's a very trial and error process, and it's going to involve a lot of fits and starts and blind alleys. And the emails and private correspondence and lab notes, none of that really matters to the process beyond what the scientist winds up representing as true, to the extent that their paper is transparently based on data and the data that they draw their conclusions from are available. Beyond that, Freedom of Information Act requests are just another political ploy to attack science.
Yeah. I think the latest I heard from another freedom had to hand over well.
Yes.
Food babe, which is like he's saying, this is just wasting my time, and I can't even think what she's going to find in them. But I know, no matter what she's going to find, she's going to.
Exactly, and that's the part of it that is unethical and really should be illegal, because it's wasting taxpayer money to take a scientist out of the lab to basically spend his or her time funding the efforts of his or her political opponents to seek information to spin against them.
Yeah.
That's not the way democracy is supposed to work, and that's not the way that transparency is supposed to work, or the intent of that law.
Yeah. Okay, we're coming up for the last 5 minutes. I think we can start to wrap up the show. So I can't remember what order I do. I get the final thoughts first, or
do the soapbox first.
Yes, okay, we'll do so. So, Sean, you've got a soapbox moment here. And if people want to get in touch with you, they've got any questions, and got a little thing coming.
Oh, great. Okay. Well, I would just say, yeah, find me online at seanotto.com or at thewaronscience.com. Check out the book. I think that you will really, really like it. And I'd love to hear your comments and thoughts about it afterwards. You can email me, find me on my website again, and do that. And if you have a an audience that would like to, that you would like to have think about these things, have me come talk.
Right. I'll go around for the panel for your final thoughts. And Marty.
Yeah, it was really interesting to have you here talking about these things. I care a great deal about this issue since I'm a science educator and just someone who wants to see the next generation be more scientifically literate than this one.
Also help for the first time in ages to guest on a subject you know something.
Yeah.
Which helped.
Yeah, it wasn't a biologist.
Yeah. All right. And Nathan, your final thoughts, please.
Yeah, thanks for coming on. It's a really important discussion that needs to happen in a lot of other places, and I'm glad we were able to have it, and I'm glad that, yeah, I think that's it.
All right. And so we'll just wrap it up there, everyone. Apart from big thanks to Sean for taking the time out to speak to us. I thoroughly enjoyed it as well. So thumbs up in the chat room if you enjoyed it. And just to let you know, we're back in, it's 3 weeks. Our next guest is the Cybabe, which I know I mentioned already, and excited to speak to her. Yeah, we do have some other guests. I'm working on them. We should have. I know we've got one show planned on capital punishment, and I'm just trying to nail down the guest. Probably capital punishment there. Yeah, I'll hopefully get it confirmed with them very soon. But
that took a while.
Yeah, it took me a while. So yeah, and so that's what's coming up. We'll be back very soon, and hopefully you all enjoyed it. If you have any feedback, the email address, contact at trollywillogic on Twitter at trollywillogic, and you can see all the links below us on the... That's it for tonight. Have a good rest of the weekend. Bye.
Bye.
See ya.
Thanks for having me on, guys. It was great, and thanks for what you do.